Good morning from the Bushwalk team. It's myself, Stef and Dave, who are on camera, who is on camera this morning. And I just want to bid you all a good morning. It's a bright and crystal clear morning this morning, I tell you. The sun came up and almost immediately that it cracked that horizon, it was blinding us in our eyes. And it looks like no mist today, not a cloud in the sky, one of these very typical for us, at least autumn days. And it's been quite a weird morning. We've been listening to sporadic reports of Brent keeping you entertained and informed about these drag marks from that male leopard that he's hot on the tracks of finding this morning. Isn't that exciting? Hopefully he can find something for you, hey? The whole night last night we've been hearing lions. They were roaring pretty much non-stop from round about 10 o'clock to about 10 past 3 this morning was when I heard the lions roar for the last time. And then they got a bit quiet. That could mean one of two things. Either they've decided that marking territory is over, or they've decided that they need to move on, that they've established their claim over this particular area and they've moved on to something else. In any event, we're here to find out exactly where they've gone. No tracks so far on the western or the northern edge of quarantine here close to the DRC, close to camp. We're definitely going to be checking more now towards the west and the south and see where they've gone from there. But just have a look at this fantastic thing that we've got here. We've had that bright, early, crystal clear sunshine. And then over my shoulder, we've got what's left of the full moon. The full moon is now waning. In other words, it's getting smaller. And have a look at that. Bright and clear. Obviously, not a no disturbance in the sky. And you're getting this lovely shot that Dave is busy doing there for you. Those dark patches on the moon, people originally thought when they first started observing the moon with any scientific interest that they were oceans. And even today they're called seas on the moon that you're having a look at over there, although we know now that those are remnants of ancient lava flows from when the moon's core was still active. Now though, moon's core is dead, or dormant I should say. It's not active anymore. All right. So what we're doing is we're looking for tracks going up and leading on the ring road that goes around quarantine. It's a good road to look for tracks on. The sand here on top of these crests in the Sabi Sands is made of this very loose granitic type soil that holds a track incredibly well. What I think I'm going to try and do is show you an example of one of these tracks that we're talking about. It'll be of something, probably not be of these lions just yet, but it'll be of something, a zebra or wildebeest or an impala. They quite often use these open areas at night time for refuge. A big open area like we're on at the moment, you can see all around us over here, literally doesn't offer much cover at all for anything that's trying to sneak up on animals. And you find that because of this, large concentrations or large herds of animals, for this area at least anyway, will come and basically sleep. For lack of a better word, they don't sleep too much. I wouldn't if I was an impala, but try and sleep as much as they can, at least on top of these open areas, and then move into the thicker bush areas when the sun comes up. All right, let me see if I can show you what I mean by holding a track. And here you have some zebra. This is the Burchell's or the plain zebra. So this is a zebra, or an odd-toed ungulate, and Joey has just asked me if we have impala that are quite common, what is an uncommon antelope? The uncommon antelope that I would see over here next to this zebra track would probably be a sable antelope or a roan antelope there, Joey. So that would be probably for me the most astonishing thing to find on this particular road would be the track of a roan or a sable. We're expecting sable to come out of the Kruger National Park into the Sabi Sands during this dry season or during this end of the drought that we're having at the moment, because the Sabi Sands is quite a lot of surface water pumped into pans, of course, but we have quite a lot of surface water and that'll start to bring animals from deep within the Kruger where they have no pumped surface water and to start drinking at the pans that we have around most of the camps over here. But just have a look how crisp that track is. You can see the frog toe. There's the frog toe, there's the hoof, the leading edge of the hoof, and this is of a young plains or Burchell zebra. And you can see how crisp it is, and that's what I'm looking for this morning, tracking this male lion, or at least trying to find out exactly what direction he's gone in before we pass over the tracking expedition to a person like Brent, who absolutely lives for tracking and finding big game. So that's what we're going to be using these soils for. Very, very good for holding tracks, these soils. What I'm doing there is I'm just making sure that I obliterate any sort of mark of my presence. I don't want to drive around and see circled tracks around. I'm sure no one else wants to see that I've circled tracks around here. This is one of the small things that I like to do to minimize my passing through the bush as much as I can. Oh, it's a very clear day today. Generally in May, because we have these chilly evenings, but there's still quite a lot of moisture in the sky, we have mist developing at night time. Now mist, as some of you might know, it's a cloud that forms on the ground. Dew point temperature, or the point at which water condenses out of the air, happens very close to the ground during these May mornings, in particular when you still have a little bit of moisture. Not too much moisture this year, I must be honest, we've had very little in terms of moisture this year, but nevertheless, May mornings are quite often categorized by mist. None of that today though. And so we're getting these valleys around us just starting to be bathed in this golden light. I must say, I quite enjoy it. Let's have a look here. Now this is one of the termite mounds that is still open. These big termite mounds, Macrotermes, they build these big termite mounds. They've almost all of them have closed their termite mounds at the moment. These little guys are still open. And here we have a chamber. And in that chamber, we've got some spider webs. And in that spider web, we've got a daddy long leg spider. Now, what I'm going to point at with the grass is not the daddy long leg spider. It's the daddy long legs spider's prey. That is the prey. The actual spider is hiding away from me right now, but it's down there. There we go. You can see the spider in the back of the web at the end of my grass retreating. Daddy long leg spider, very, very common spider here in this part of the world. They very often like to build their nests. They make these messy, tangled nests, or webs, I should say, inside of termite mounds where they snatch unsuspecting termites off of the tunnels. And that's what you're looking at over there. So what you were looking at over there is where the termites have their air conditioning vent. It's where all the hot air in the termite mound escapes. You can actually see in the distance over there, you can see a very well established chimney, and that is one of my favorite termite mounds. I'm gonna go straight there right now. The reason for that is that I quite enjoy seeing what's happening there. It's for me a little micro ecosystem, and I want to see if they've managed to close up their vent, the top of their chimney. On the way there, one of the most surprising things to happen to us this morning was me waking up to the chorus of a bull baboon giving a bark this morning from right above our camp. Since I've been here, which is now a year roundabout, I think just a little bit over a year, I haven't heard a bull baboon bark on Juma's property at all. And now I can hear not only a bull baboon, but I can hear some baby baboons as well. So it's a good thing. Baboons look like a baboon troop, or an offshoot of a baboon troop. Looks like it's made its way back onto Juma, which is quite nice. All right. So they actually haven't closed up their chimney. This is their chimney. This would be the vent for all the hot air that comes out of the chimney. And this is pretty much as wide as what it was last week. I'll ask Dave to come up here and see if he can show you. There you go, Dave. It actually looks like it's been damaged. You see here? Look at all... ow, ow, ow. That's now what happens when a soldier decides that you've gotten a bit too close to... ah! You can see him working those chelicerae into my skin there. Those things are razor sharp, and at the moment feels like I've been stapled with a staple gun. I didn't even see him there. Tack like lightning. And you can see what he's doing. Shame. He's just protecting his nest. Oh, that's now right onto the nerves at the end of my finger. Dropped him back into his hole. There he is over there, so no harm done. That's him right there. You can have a look. So something has been feeding here before we got here. These loose portions of clay are what's actually what was left here. And the reason why all these soldiers are on high alert is because there was something feeding here, probably a bird of some sort. What they will do is they will now patch this up tonight, probably throughout the day, but by tonight it'll be patched up and then it'll be closed. Gee whiz. Well, good luck for the rest of the winter. I love this term of mine. It always offers the most amazing things. You can actually see over here. Ah, and Jamie, while I'm busy having a look at what possibly could be the culprit for what opened this, you see this little dropping over here? That's from a little nocturnal, looks like a little nocturnal predator. I would almost say it's probably a lizard of some sort. Has been digging open this, and that's exactly why. No bird droppings, I didn't see any birds here. So it's not a bird, it's something nocturnal. Now James has asked me how many kilometers I'm going to walk with the walking team today. James, probably, I don't actually know. I'd like to go and see if we can go all the way west. I want to see if we can get onto Impala Plains today and then back again. So it's a round trip of probably around 5 miles or so that we're hoping to get to today. We'll see. Now above us, we've got a collection of birds that have just flown in. Those are all a collection of starlings, long-tailed or magpie shrikes. Those are the ones with the long tails. And a bunch of starlings. And a buffalo weaver. So three or four different species of birds sitting on top of the tree to get the first rays of the sun to warm up. And a hornbill. Have a look, if you go further right over there, Dave, there must be about 20 or so birds inside there. That's called a bird party. It's when we find a whole bunch of birds sharing a common resource. In this case, the common resource is the warmth from the sun. That noise you're hearing in the background is from grey hornbills. And that's that. I think for now we're going to try and get off of this termite mound and we're going to try and cross the drainage line in front of us. And because we're going to do that, we need to keep our ears and eyes open moving through that thick bush. I'm going to send you through to Brent.
So, very disappointing. It's not often we find such a nice, big, fresh drag mark. But it seems like the hyenas beat us to it. Unfortunately, the tracks of that leopard went back east into Torchwood. Now, that could be two different males. It could be Tingana, or it could be Gajima. I've seen both in that particular area. So just on the chance that he managed to eat enough to become thirsty, we're coming down towards the Buffalo's Hook waterhole now to see if maybe he got enough of a full belly to feel like having a drink. So Kyle is wondering, he says part of him is wondering whether Tingana is moving out of our area because of Gajima. Kyle, I don't think that's the case at all, to be honest. Tingana is still very much the dominant leopard in this area. He's quite a bit older than Gajima, quite a bit bigger. So not yet, but he will make an effort of patrolling his boundaries. And now he's got such a big, big home range that it's very, very difficult for him to be everywhere at once. Unfortunately, nothing at the waterhole. So he's constantly on the move, but he's very much definitely still the dominant male for us. So another update, the Inkahumas and that one Birmingham have been found. Unfortunately, they did not come all the way south into Juma, and they've stayed to the north in Buffalo's Hook. Okay, so we might lose you as we go through this dip, so let's jump back to Steph quickly, who's got an interesting little insect.
What we're trying to find you right here is a robber fly. Now, robber flies, right there, are quite interesting things in that they are the assassins of the insect world, or one of the assassins of the insect world. This particular robber fly is cold, and that's why it's not moving. We wouldn't have allowed us to get this close at all to it if it was a little bit warmer. I'm just trying to find you a nice angle on it. You're now looking at its face. That's its eye peeking out at the bottom of the screen there, or at the bottom of that stick. And what's quite interesting is these guys will quite often snatch. There's its eye, two eyes. You can see how big their eyes are. And what they do is they sit on the ground or near the ground, and they then look at insects flying overhead, predominantly grasshoppers. They then rush up from the ground, snatch the grasshopper, encase it in these legs. You can see it has a basket-like leg structure or leg arrangement. Basket-like leg arrangement. Catches it and then sticks a proboscis called... Well, it's proboscis, sticks its proboscis into the head of the grasshopper, usually piercing the brain and killing the grasshopper. They then fall down to the ground, and then he sucks out all the grasshopper's juices, and that's how he gets his food. Robber fly, cold this morning. The wings are tucked tightly against the abdomen, and that's why you actually can't see the wings at the moment. But they are there. Awesome. Nice one, Dave. On that note, back to Brent.
So we're on the northern boundary. The lions are about there and about 2 kilometers. So unfortunately, oh, you never know, they might get moving in the morning. I will keep my ear out on the radio. But I know Jamie gave you that update on Tsalalas and Shadow. Fascinating stuff. And I've got a theory about what's going on. I think now that Salahesh's cub is approaching a year and might be becoming independent in the next few months, that she might be sequestering off that core part of her territory where the cub grew up around the Manuleti River to the cub. And because she's such a big female and in her prime, she's going to push west and maybe even push Shadow a little bit west. Whoa, green pigeons! Oh, bursting out of the bushes around us. Let's just go try a bit forward. They're sitting there. Don't fly. They are incredibly beautiful. And they have wonderful colouring that's going to come out spectacularly in this early morning light. There we go. Look at that. A very distinct yellow eye, and there we can actually see their feet quite nicely. Now their feet are very important, so they are the only member of the sort of dove and pigeon family that has zygodactyl feet. Now zygodactyl feet means they've got two facing forward and two facing back, and the reason for this is because they're a fruit eater. And the Afrikaans, which is Afrikaans name for them, and Afrikaans is a language in South Africa. It's Wim's home language. Their name is the papagaai dove. Basically means the parrot dove. So their foot structure is very similar to a parrot. And you can even see their beaks are hooked. So they've evolved separately from the rest of the dove species. And you can see, look at them. They climb like parrots. They move like parrots. And that is an evolutionary adaptation to help them feed on fruits. They can climb upside down. Most of the other dove and pigeon family are all seed eaters. So they've got three toes facing forward and one back, and they tend to feed on the ground. Whereas these guys are very much tree feeders. There we go. You can see even the bill has started evolving to look more like a parrot's beak than a dove beak. Very, very pretty birds. The African green pigeon. And we can often get big flocks of them, especially now as resources become harder to find. We're going to possibly find some big flocks of them on certain tree species. And they're all puffed up from the cold.
I hear a leopard.
VM just heard a leopard calling. We're just trying to figure out where, because he's got his cans on.
What's it back?
I'm tortured. I think it's the same leopard tracks we've just been following. So, that unfortunately is that male leopard, and he's calling, but he's calling back east over our boundary. But isn't that wonderful? Not often we get to see a nice close-up view of these green pigeons. Oh, and yeah, elephant as well. Breaking branches. The parrot dove, papagaai dave. So we're talking about leopards in the western sections, and Siberia is asking about Anderson, and I'll get to Anderson in a second, Siberia. So, as I was saying, what I think is happening, which is very normal for female leopards, is that they give a core part of their territory to their female daughters, so they don't really have to start fighting as they become independent. And I think we might be seeing a bit more of Tsalalas on Arethusa, and she might start pushing shadow further to the east and towards us. And that'll create a very interesting dynamic, because what's shadow going to do? Is she going to start pushing Karula? Or will she fill this vacuum up here in the sort of northwest where we've seen Sakani a few times? So it's going to be very interesting. And there's the culprit who was breaking branches. Hello, mister. Elephant bull. Just heard that, almost like a rifle shot. I'm pretty sure it was from him. And you can see the fork-tailed drongo is picking up any insect that he disturbs as he walks. And he's about to move off into a very, very thick block. So we'll let him be. Maybe he's trailing a breeding herd. We'll go have a look on the other side of the block. But as I was saying, I think we're going to go try head up to the high ground up ahead and get a report from Arethusa and see if we can possibly go see Tsalalas. So that's my plan now. Jamie was going to head that way, but unfortunately the gremlins have invaded. So we will go that way now. So Siberia is wondering about Anderson. And I was speaking to my friend Tristan last night, and he's only been back from leave for 3 days, and he's seen Anderson every day around Sibambili. So he's around there, so who knows, maybe he'll come and steal that kill from Tsalalas while we're watching. Oh, so chilly in the bottom of these little dips at the moment. And that's one of the things I really love about being out here in the bush, is that when you think you got something all figured out, some slight little change, the independence of a female leopard cub, a male leopard becoming nomadic or coming into its prime and moving to an area, just changes the dynamics. They're in constantly in flux. So nothing is a solid rule. Everything's fluid and changing constantly. And that is one of the joys, that every day we go out, and we'll see something different or new, or learn something different and new. has. I'm just going to update the other vehicles where we heard that leopard audio. Stations audio of an Ingwe to the east of Cheetah Cut Line between Buffalo's Hook Cut Line and Pipeline Road. Similar area to where we had the tracks going east. But look at this gorgeous light that's coming through. These winter mornings, even though they are really chilly in the beginning, are just absolutely exquisite. We're talking about the Nkuhuma pride just now. As I said, they're just over there. They're probably about 800 meters from the boundary. So we know that there's 8 Styx cubs and now 2 Nkuhuma cubs with a possible few more on the way in about 3 to 4 weeks. And James Bear is wondering, well, how many cubs are attributed to the Birmingham boys? So far it would be 10. But James, one must be very careful about saying it's definitely the Birmingham boys. And in a lot of areas, 50% of the cubs are born to the non-pride males. So these are males that are not in coalitions, and they sort of meander around the peripheries and through the territories of multiple different coalitions, and they sort of sneakily mate on the side. So, and in doing that, because they're not part of a coalition, because they can't attack a coalition of 4 if you're a single lion, their sort of way to spread their genetics is to sneak around and mate on the edges. And it's actually quite a successful ploy. And I mean, in certain areas where they've done genetic testing on the cubs, as up to 50% of the cubs have been born to these sneaky peripheral males. And being right on the edge of the Kruger and the Manuleti, where there's a large reservoir of lions, there is a strong possibility that we definitely have these males that sneak in. Also, these prides do move into the Kruger and Manuleti from time to time, where we don't have nearly a good idea about what's happening. So we're going to scoot off right to the northwestern corner on the high ground, get an update on what's happening with those leopards and Arethusa. And while we do that, let's jump back onto foot with Steph.
Well, if there's anyone that can find you a leopard this morning, it's definitely Brent. He definitely has the knack for it. But while he does that, it allows us to explore all these funny little bushes and plants. And one of the most interesting beetles that we found this year is the one you're having a look at right now. It's called the flea beetle. Flea beetle because it's got this habit of using its incredibly powerfully developed back legs to jump away from danger. And that is uncommon in the beetle world. To have a beetle that jumps is almost like having a giraffe that can do backflips to get away from trouble. It's just uncommon. But another thing about this flea beetle is that they only live on this particular tree. This is a rus. It's the only rus that grows in this particular area, and on it is these flea beetles. And we've only just found this year. These beetles have obviously been here forever, but it's just been myself that's only uncovered this beetle. I've been walking past this particular rus for the last 16 years and I've never noticed this interesting beetle on it. Now, one of the things with this beetle is that underneath this plant, when it comes to the end of the season, these beetles will dig into the soil, lay their eggs, and there, their little, the baby beetle will then dig under the soil to about 30 centimeters, which is about this long, about a foot. There they will pupate, and they get a little encased cyst. It's about this big, and inside there will be a little pupa, a little worm, and Bushmen, or one of the ancient tribes of Africa, used to dig out the pupa and then squeeze it along the end of their arrow shaft. So not on the arrow head, but on the shaft just behind the arrow. They then would shoot it into an animal, usually the cheek or the neck, and that would cause paralysis and death of a full-grown buffalo in about 40 minutes. An 800-kilogram animal would be brought down dead in 40 minutes just from the juice from the pupa of this particular beetle. Can you believe it? Right here. Now another thing, why I actually stopped at this particular tree is this is the first time that I've actually seen the fruit on this particular tree. And I don't actually know if it's edible, to be honest with you. I'm inclined to say it's not if there's a beetle that feeds on it, which pupa can kill a buffalo in 40 minutes. So I'm not going to put it in my mouth and tell you how much it tastes or how good it tastes until I've actually decided to learn a little bit more about this particular rus. But nevertheless, it's got its seeds. What I can tell you about this rus, though, is we can speculate as to what its seed dispersal agent is. Now, generally, birds don't have teeth. And that means that they have to use a crop. A crop, or their gizzard, is what's inside, just in their throat area. And they put rough things inside there, things like stones, things like bits and pieces of sand. They put in their crop, and muscular action causes this crop to move around. And what it'll do is it'll break up the food that they eat, and then it goes down into their tummy. Now you can always see if a tree's seed is aimed mainly at mammals or aimed at a bird. I would say initially this says to me bird because it's small. Next, what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and open it. And there is my next answer. Inside there you'll see that the fleshy covering of this particular seed is very thin. And then you've got the hard seed on the inside. It's a very thin covering of flesh. In other words, the flesh or the meat reward for eating this small little seed is virtually non-existent. And that says to me further, it's for a bird. So a bird will eat lots of these that rub together, that rub off that little covering of flesh. It would then move into the bird's intestine. The bird will then go and sit somewhere in a bush, generally sitting in a bush like this guari right here, to come and feed on the guaris and then deposit its dung, and that is how this seed will be dispersed to the bottom of the tree, in close association with a tree with other seeds of its kind. And that then tells me that this particular seed, or this particular bush, is dispersed by birds. James, while I'm busy looking at what else we can find over here, James Richards has actually asked me what plant gives the most interesting seeds. For me, I think in the whole world, the most interesting seed has to be one of the coconuts. It baffles me that a plant has managed to use the sea as a seed dispersal agency. So for me, the coconut has to be the one that has definitely the most bizarre seed dispersal. But I think out here, I'd have to say the Natal mahogany tree, or perhaps even the pod mahogany tree, one of the pod mahoganies. Entandophragma is the genus, and what it does is it creates a seed pod that looks very similar to a sausage. The seed pod itself has got these creases or crevices in the seed pod, and as the tree dries out and withdraws its moisture from its branches during the dry season, so this seed pod splits open and looks identical to a peeled banana, only without the banana part on the inside. But the seed pod basically peels open along these creases, and in it are winged seed pods. Now, these trees grow on top of mountains on the Lubombo mountain range on the eastern side of the Kruger National Park, and at the top of the hill you're going to get lots of wind, and so these winged seed pods then float away from the tree and disperse that way. And that probably is, for me out here, the most interesting or the most abnormal one. All right. Now, Brent has got some elephants for you, so we'll see you in a bit.
Look at this. I mean, we were rushing off to the west, but we came across these Ellie bulls, and in this morning light, it was just too beautiful to pass up on. And look at that. Absolutely gorgeous. Liam is doing some tricky camera work. He's using his hand as an extra lens hood to get that sort of ethereal light coming through. Some big bulls. There is a breeding herd around here as well. But what we notice is three big bulls. The really big guy is still at the back to the left of that one. And he looked like he had massive tusks.
Crash cut. All right, sorry about that. Brent's having some signal issues and you caught us busy going through a seep line. Now, seep lines are where water seeps out of the ground in this particular area. Usually happens just off the crest and just before the drainage line, probably about, let's say about two-thirds from the crest down, you start getting these seep lines. Absolutely characterized by a couple of different plants. Characterized firstly by this plant. This is Waltheria indica. And then secondly, by this plant here, which is purple panweed. And purple panweed, for me, is one of the most delightful smells out here. You crush it up like that to get the smells coming out. And then you just bring it up to your nose, and it has the most delightful camphor smell. Camphor cream is how I like to describe it. It's a beautiful smell. The more you crush it, the more you smell it, the less like camphor it gets. And the more, I don't actually know what to call it, it gets like, but it definitely doesn't become pleasant. So just a little bit of bruising on the leaves, and then camphor. Locally, this tree is used for scenting up a house, so as an air freshener or a fragrance provider. It doesn't have any nutritional value that I know, and definitely no medicinal value that I know about either. But there we go. What I did see with my eye as you came to us was this grass orb spider, and I'm gonna see if I can show it to you. I found her. She's sitting on the periphery, Dave. You're going to have to come around this side. She's sitting on the periphery of her web. And there she is. This is going to provide a very difficult task for Dave here. But there she is there. A tiny, tiny little spider. One of the grass orb spiders. There she's turning. You can just get her legs there now, hey Dave? That's a female. She's got this beautifully constructed orb web between the Waltheria and this forb that I don't know what it is. And she's just hiding from us. She saw us coming and she quickly made her way to her safety place so that in case her web gets taken, she doesn't get taken with it, and then she can quickly do running repairs on the web or rebuild it, which shouldn't take too long. They take about 40 minutes or so to build a web. I just find it one of the most amazing things. Now Brent is up and running again, and that means that he's sorted out hopefully some of the little gremlins that have crept into his system today, and we're going to be sending you back to him to carry on with the update I'm sure he was giving you.
Look at that. There's that big tusker that Vim and I initially saw, which made us stop and wait. And he's just moved through. Look at how lovely and long that ivory is. You can see he's streaming from his temporal glands. We haven't been able to see whether he's in must. He is in must. He's in full must. So he's trailing this breeding herd. Oh, there goes the tree. There's lions right behind us, there's elephants here. It's all happening all of a sudden. the yellow lion. So let's go. These elephants have gone into the thickets now, but wasn't that great to see such a big tusker? Now let's go see if we can see a big male lion, because that's what it sounds like. On a positive note, these elephants look like they are heading down towards the lodges. So hopefully that big tusker does make an appearance during the day on the dam cam. Hold on, male lion to the northwest. It's so funny because the morning's been relatively quiet, sedate. We've had that drag mark, and now all of a sudden, we had that monster tusker and a male lion calling really close to us. So guys, if you're wondering where Jamie is, unfortunately there's been some gremlins in her vehicle and they're back at camp trying to get it sorted as quickly as possible. So hopefully she'll be out again shortly. But till then, you're with Steph and myself, and at the moment, Steph's showing you the little things, and I'll try find the big ones. Where's my cap? Time to change hats as it warms up. Let's have a quick look what's happening here at, I would have guessed that lion to be in this general area, so eyes up Vim. Almost think he could have been either at Sydney's waterhole or on a sandy patch. I don't look too perturbed over there. Okay. Now he sounded like he was right here. Oh, what do you got there, Vim? A spoonbill. Come on, mister, give us another call. Just looking at the tracks around here. Is that, have you seen him, mate? Is
yeah.
What have you got? A flock of starlings. Then just come over here and near that termite mound in the corner there.
Termite mound? Oh, no, the other side.
Yeah. And just a little bit to the left. I thought I saw something under the bush. Nope. Somewhere. There goes the spoonbill. So VM's doing a splendid job while we try. See where this line is. And he might have been a little bit behind us in this quarry thickets here. So we're going to just keep checking quite carefully, slowly around here. And while we do that, let's just jump back on Steph. And hopefully we'll be back with a big male lion shortly.
we can't help ourselves but show you this. These caterpillars, when we find them, they are just the most beautiful. This is, of course, the dice moth caterpillar. And we've caught this dice moth caterpillar about halfway up a stick of grass because it's wanting to get warm. So this particular caterpillar has moved up the ground and out of the undergrowth and has moved up this strand of grass so it can get warm this morning, and it's standing still for us. Have a look at that. I just find these absolutely fascinating. Not much is known about them. To be honest, I've researched these at length, and there's not much that can be said about them. There's a couple of things about the plants that they like to live on, about those filaments that they've got on their body that they wave around. Their aposomatic coloration, which is those broad bands of contrasting or highly contrasting colors, those are to ward off would-be predators, but nothing much else about them. Their moth that they produce, they don't make a butterfly, they turn into or metamorphosize into a moth, is an orangey colored moth with round dots on its wings, triangular shaped wings. Quite a pretty moth, definitely not as pretty as what the caterpillar itself is. Now have a look. I bumped the caterpillar with the grass, so that was naughty of me, so I think we're gonna leave it for now. But I'm also sitting next to one of these trees that I want to show you. This is an Ozaroa. This particular genus of tree is Ozaroa, and I know it's an Ozaroa tree because of this, what they call herringbone venation on the leaves. Herringbone venation. And that's how I identified it, and it's also quite hairy on the bottom. It's got these very, very fine hairs on the bottom. Ozaroa is the genus of these trees, and why I like this particular tree is that a tracker friend of mine called Richard, one of my dearest friends out here, told me a wonderful story about what he used to do with this tree as a young boy. And they used to milk the sap out of this tree. Now, how you milk the sap from one of these trees without using a fancy instrument that's built for it, that the rubber industry made, is you make a tiny incision in the bark of the tree in the form of a V. So you cut into the cambium layer just like that, and then you leave it, and what it'll do is it'll start weeping. Now obviously we can't wait for this tree to weep, so I'm just going to show you. You see that milky stuff that's coming out there? I'm going to show you on my blade. That milky latex that the tree's got, that is sticky. And what this tree does, if you collect enough of this particular sap, and my tracker used to do, is he used to take a tin, usually a cool drink tin that he had. He used to put as much of this sap as he could into the tin, and then over very low heat, he used to heat this sap. And what it does is it boils the water out of the sap, and eventually you end up with a very sticky substance that with a little bit of cooking oil on your hands, you can turn into a rope, into a string. And what he used to do there is he then used to go to where birds came through to water and drink, and he used to wrap this sticky rope around the stick that birds used to come and sit at. So birds would fly in, land on the stick before they go down to water. Birds used to land on the stick and get stuck there. It's called bird lime, and that's a very good way of catching birds. The birds get all sticky, their wings get stuck. He used to come, take the sticks off of his bird lime, and then obviously that was the way he had lunch for that day. Very naughty guy, Richard, one of the most classic individuals I've ever met in the bush, and this is one of the plants that he used to use to get himself some food when snacks were short. And another thing that I can't help doing is peeling these basils. What? That there that you're having a look at is the leaf and the discarded shell husk of the Osmium canum, another one of the plants I absolutely love smelling. It's a loosely termed the wild basil out here, and can be used to flavor food. A very basil-y smell. Now, Justin has asked about those filaments on the dice moth caterpillar. Just to go back to the dice moth caterpillar, obviously where Justin comes from, there are caterpillars that have got hairs on them. And Justin, some of the caterpillars in this particular area have got those hairs that definitely are venomous, or poisonous is the actual word to use, or irritant is actually more the correct word. These ones are not. These ones just wave around, and they use them as a distraction. My feeling is that with these contrasting colors, as you can see, the black and the white with the red legs and the orangey legs, that they use it to draw attention to themselves to say, hey, look, I'm here. I don't want to hide away. Look at my colors, and definitely don't put me in your mouth because I'm going to be distasteful or I could even harm you. And they draw attention to themselves that way. What they don't want to do is be mistaken for something and injured in the process while the bird decides that they're distasteful or not. So I think these particular filaments are attention grabbing. It's definitely not for mates. They will mate with one another when they are in their moth phase. So if I were to guess at what this is, I would say it's absolutely just an attention grabber. Look, I'm here. I'm very colorful and I'm displaying my danger colors and I don't want you to harm me. These dice moth caterpillars. One of those things, we really can't help showing you these things. They are truly superb. Oh. Let's carry on. And Aaron in New Zealand has asked me a nice question. What tree or plant is the most important out here? Aaron, that's a good question. I think that the most important tree out here would probably be the marula tree, if I were to name a big fancy tree. I personally feel that all the trees are quite enjoyable out here. I quite enjoy all of them. But definitely the marula is the one. Very similar to an elephant or to a lion, it holds a lot of importance here. It's one of the keystone trees. Have a look at that tree over there. That's a marula tree. So Aaron, that's a marula. And why I like it, it's because it produces a fruit. That particular fruit is eaten by almost anything here. It's fed upon by birds, it's fed upon by insects, it's fed upon by animals, it's fed upon by elephant, baboons. You name it, even jackal eat that fruit. And so forms a very important part of the diet out here. Quite a conspicuous fruit. It's also used by people, and so it's conserved by people. It's not only valued by animals, but it's also valued by people. And that to me is important. To me it just strikes one of these things that we've got to try and understand this balance between people and animals. We have to celebrate those things. Now I've spied a termite mound there, so I want to go climb up on top of it. And Aqua wants to know if there's any plants with first aid or medicinal properties out here. Aqua, absolutely. There are absolutely plants out here with medicinal and first aid properties. For instance, this one right here. This is a senna. This particular senna, the root of this senna, if you take the root of the senna and you steep it in some hot water and you drink it, it is a very effective laxative. And there are many trees, many, many, many trees. I'd say probably the good majority of the plants out here are used to some form of another in three ways. Spiritual, placebo, and medicinal. By placebo, I mean it's given to somebody that's showing symptoms of something, but not really exhibiting any particular type of effect or problem, I should say, and it has a dramatic effect on that person's frame of mind. Then magical or spiritual, plants that are used in ceremonies, plants that are used in conjunction with other plants that have certain spiritual connotations, and then plants that are medicinal, that have an actual chemical compound in them that does something at a physiological level. There are quite a few of them out here. And that was just one, the senna, that has a laxative in it. I've heard it's not a laxative that has a dramatic effect. It's just very effective. Quite a mild laxative then. You do get ones that are quite virulent, for lack of a better word. The large fruited fever berry. I was once told a story on a trail, a friend of mine that was doing trails in the park. He mentioned to one of his trails groups that the large fruited fever berry was an intense laxative. And unbeknownst to him, this guest took a fruit off of the tree, put it in her pocket, she was suffering quite badly, put this fruit in her mouth and chewed it, and had to be airlifted to a hospital because it had the desired effect. Shame. And on a trail, that's something that you don't need. Right, now I've got to the edge of this Turma Mountain. What's immediately apparent is the fact that aardvarks have been digging here. Now, Brandon, you've just asked me a question all the way from Ohio, and I only got half of it. I think this termite mound is having an effect on my radio, so we're just going to get final control to send me through that question again, and then I will answer it absolutely. Okay, Brandon, so you've asked what advice I can give someone going on their first walk in South Africa, their first bushwalk in South Africa. Well, excuse me, that was an elephant that was having a bit of a problem or something. The first thing I say is probably get yourself fit. Get yourself fit, and if you can get yourself used to warmer temperatures, definitely do. It's the thing that catches people out the most out here. It's fitness, and you can't enjoy a walk out here in the bush doing a bushwalk if you're not fit. You end up being very tired, and you if you're not used to heat, it has added effects. It can exponentially make getting dehydrated worse, and you lost concentration. You're not aware of your surroundings, and you know, then it doesn't make any sense if you're battling through a walk. So absolutely, I'd work on fitness. Secondly, I'd work on my heat tolerance. And then from there, you could probably work on what equipment you're going to take with you. I'm not a big fan of carrying massive weight on my back for bushwalks. Depending on what you're going to do, if you're going to just be walking in the day, or if you're going to be spending over the night, you definitely need to give some consideration to what you're going to carry, and weight is a killer. So keep your weight of your backpack down to the absolute minimum. Keep your fitness up, and if you can, get yourself a little bit more heat resistant. And that pretty much is all the advice that I've got. We can go into much more detail, of course, what books you should bring in, a pair of binoculars, what shoes, but those are all actually irrelevant. Those are all such personal preferences. It makes choosing very difficult. Now, Dave, I think I'm going to go this way around. Have a look around. I quite enjoy these termite mounds because they give you, not much, but they give you a vista into the bush. It's quite nice. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to follow these line, or this line of marula trees. You can see the marulas generally grow on crests. On the crests, you usually find different grass species to in the valleys. We haven't found any fresh footprints of anything in the valley, so let's go and check the crests and see what we can find on top of the crests. And while we make our way through this thick bush over here, Brent has got an update for you.
So, Vim and I followed the tracks of a male lion into Sibambili, but both of us are not convinced it's the same one we heard roaring. That one sounded still maybe a little bit to the north. So we've done a loop, we found those tracks, we followed them to where they crossed, and now we're just slowly heading back towards Sydney's in case that male was still on his way. Just checking carefully that we don't miss any tracks. Is an incredible sound, and it just breaks through all the other sounds out there, that deep roar of a male lion. It's going very slowly. So we've got a well-read Australian named Chris who said they've read that lions can deal with inbreeding, and that they can up to about 6 generations. Is it the same with leopards? Deal with inbreeding for a couple of generations, but it's sort of past that sort of 4th, 5th generation, and it starts to get a bit iffy, and certain bad traits start coming through, stunted growth, deformities. But yes, leopards can also deal with inbreeding. Now, Jamie was chatting about the Matimbas before she had a gremlin creep in. And the update is they arrived at Sibambili camp, which is about 5-6 kilometers to the west of us. And they were chasing those poor 2 young males we saw at Sydney's a while ago, the 2 breakaway young males, and they got chased a lot around there. They have headed straight back south. They are now, yesterday they already crossed in back into Londolozi. Come on, Mr. Lion. So, chatting about Jamie, it seems like the tech team have been beating gremlins with baseball bats, and she's back on the road. So let's go see what she's up to.
I mean, I haven't been doing much in the way of gremlin batting myself, but our tech team has been exceptionally hard at work trying to figure out what on earth is happening with Wendy, since there doesn't seem to be any correlation between moving, stopping, talking, not talking, before we just vanish off your screens. But we are back up and running for now, and we've started off with a nice group of Dugger boys that are around here. One with a very bald face, although he's moved off now. So I've been just listening to the goings-on on the Game Drive channel, wondering what's happening with those lions and trying to figure out where we can go and help to look for things without risking disappearing once again. There's some couple of angry elephants off towards Galagopan, so I think we'll go and have a look and see what's upset them. Try and figure out if it's to do with any of those missing lions, since there just seem to be lions scattered all over the show, or whether it's something else. Lots and lots of big elephant bulls though around at the moment. Chances are that is what's causing the upset. And then, of course, it could also just be a weaning tantrum from one of the elephant calves. But it seems as though Brent has managed to find those baboons we've heard calling all morning, so let's head across there.
Hello, baboons. So we're sitting quietly and listening at Sydney's waterhole, and there's a big troop of baboons arriving, chasing each other about. Now, the positive thing is if there is a lion and they spot it, they are going to shout from the top of the trees. Nice big group. Some have gone over the wall already, but I'd say easily 30 or 40. Oh, look at the little ones playing. Tackle. So nice we've started seeing baboons again. They are definitely one of the more interesting animals to spend time with. constantly up to something. Wonderful to watch the little ones play. Now, they've got a very interesting and quite a complex social structure. So there's not one dominant male, but there's a sort of a group of dominant males. Depending on the size of the troop, it can be up to 10. In a troop this size, you're probably sitting about 4 or 5 dominant males. And it's a very, very competitive section with those males changing constantly. And if one of those males sort of has an injury, has a limp, the other dominant ones, or the ones below him on the dominant scale, will literally just attack and beat the daylights out of him, just to move one rung up on the hierarchy amongst the males. And we're trying to look for a male. Now, at the moment, I'm just seeing young ones and females, but there should be a big male somewhere there. He might be on the other side of the... There, with his back to us, could be a male, but it's a bit... Yes, I think there. The one with his back to us, basking in the early morning sun and staying out of all the shenanigans of the young ones, is probably a big male. You can see he looks... No, it's not. It's two. So not a big male. It's two grooming each other. That's why they looked a bit bigger. But even though still, I think the one with his back to us is a male. Tumble to the left. Big game going on there. There's a male. Deborah, the armchair tram is assuming it's the same troop that we saw with Jamie. It's possible. It was in this area, so it is very possible it is the same troop. We saw another troop yesterday, I think it was, around Vuyatela. So there could be two troops in the area at the moment. And of course, with the drought and the lack of food around is the reason we're seeing them all. They're having to move further and further to find sustenance. Oh, look at that little one jump up. Oh, here we go. Boom! Just hear them making noise in the distance. So Ellen, who's in North Dakota, is wondering, can a large male baboon be a danger to the little ones? Sometimes, Ellen, they can get very aggressive, but not normally. Now, a big male baboon has longer canines than a lion. So they have impressive defensive, and also, even though they are quite a bit smaller than us, they're incredibly strong as well. And most female leopards would think twice about tangling with a baboon. There's a male walking up on top, but disappearing. And you can see the size difference there between the male and female. Well, that's a young male. We have it. Definitely not a dominant. Now, I'm hoping we'll see one of the really big boys. Let's keep looking. There we go. There's a big, big male. And see the female's presenting to him. So when a female baboon comes into estrus, she gets swelling and coloration around the buttocks. It becomes quite red. Everyone's stopping to greet the big male. If he can have a sniff. Oh, that cam is on again. Like little children. Now they're very, very cautious about where they drink. And you often find they see they're drinking where there's quite a lot of hoof action. So there's little puddles in there, so they don't have to go right to the edge of the main body of water. They are very, very conscious of crocodiles. The tummy's saying it's so funny how they sit. It's very human-like. Well, they are a primate, so somewhere way back in the past, we do share a common ancestor with them. But a very, very long time ago, probably well over 3-4 million years ago. Oh, look at that baby hanging on for dear life to mom's chest. Now, that's what one of the things I love about baboons, the babies and where they hang on. And as we saw, sometimes they do ride cowboy style on mom's back. So Justin's wondering, are baboons one of the more aggressive primates? And also, being omnivores, how often do they get meat? They can be very aggressive, and those big males are strong and with those massive canines. And they can become problems in certain places, raiding camps and attacking people for food. Fortunately, we don't have that problem out here. But as in terms of them being omnivores and how often they get meat, they probably find some meat almost every day. Whether it be a lizard or a baby bird or bird egg, more form of protein. But impalas and baboons quite often have a very strong association. Not so much in this area, but in other areas. Until you get to impala lambing season. And then once lambing season happens, the impala tries to stay very far away from baboons. And those big male baboons often grab baby impala and eat them. But the baboons are moving off now from the waterhole, and I think that lion is still inside Buffle's Hook. So I'm going to stick to my original plan and see if we can go find some leopards on Arethusa. So while we leave these primates that are wandering around on all fours, let's go to another primate who's wandering around on two legs.
So Brent's calling me a primate now, is he? Well, we have to see. I'm not as good as my comebacks with him. But have a look at this. One of the things that we are finding all over the place at the moment are obviously rutting ram impalas. And this is a dead male impala. It's a prime male, and I know that because if you look at the tips of their horns, of its horns, they are parallel to one another. The tips. If they were like this, it would be a young male impala, and if it was like this, it would be an old male impala past its prime. So this is a prime male impala. This would be an impala that was in charge of a harem, or it was an impala that was vying for the dominance of a harem of females, this particular male impala. Why it died is speculation. Generally during the rut they can be injured, fatally injured. They can also, because they're so distracted with their harems and the females and dominance displays, they quite often get preyed upon, these big male impala. Or it could have just been sick. Very tough to say from just the head. But this particular skull is in a remarkable state of preservation. One of the things that I was noting on is that when you are watching over the next couple of days, because the rut's almost finished, you'll notice these impalas will look at one another. Here's his eye here. They'll look at one another, they'll then bend their horns forward, and they will joust. They will move with one another like this. And all of a sudden, one will make a move and they'll check. They'll check that that thrust, for lack of a better word. They check it through their horn, and you can see evidence of that. Have a look at how worn these ridges are from this particular male checking over the years and practicing. Have a look at those ridges there. Those are now worn, smooth. And on the left-hand side, which is probably the side that he was most dominant on, you can see how he's damaged those ridges. Now, these ridges are there to stop the horns from sliding past one another and inflicting damage when damage is not intended. So when they're just wrestling with one another, these ridges will stop an opponent's horns from sliding too easily past one another, and where you've got then these rapier-like points, then able to inflict some damage. Sharp, eh? Now you can imagine a 50 kilogram impala moving at speed, putting all their weight behind this. As soon as he comes in, puts his head down, they can do some damage with those horns. And that's precisely what a parallel horned impala ram is doing. They want those horn tips parallel to one another, so when they slip past an opponent's guard, they can do some damage to that. They can take it and slip past the guard, just overcome these friction ridges, and bam, in there, and that way assert his dominance. But not only that, have a look over here. This is now the nasal cavity. This particular skull is in such a good state of repair. I've seen something I've never seen before. Inside there, you've got this very, very fine venation of bone. Now that is obviously the nasal mucosa, or where the nasal cavity is. Inside there will be these filaments and these ridges where sense organelle are jam-packed. But I never knew up until this point how fine the bone structure is inside there. Have a look at that. Now, to be honest with you, I don't actually know much about the physiology of the nasal mucosa. I wouldn't be able to tell you why there's bone structure in the mucous membrane, why it's not cartilage, why it's not just tissue, soft tissue, why you need bone there. The only thing I can think about is to give it some rigidity, because that there won't be able to produce any white blood cells. It doesn't have marrow in it. So it's only there for rigidity. I just find it incredible. And that, the rest of it, there's his brain case. Relatively big brain. I just love finding things like this. Interesting, eh? That's the horn of a full-grown male impala on the end of this, or in this seepline area. It's quite possible that he died fighting. It's quite possible that he died fighting over here. These open areas, these seepline areas that we're standing in now, will become places where impala seek refuge. And just to answer Kyle's question, Kyle has wanted to know, can I find him some impala tracks? Now, Kyle, in a place like this where you've got so much grass, I can't find you tracks of an impala, but what I can find you is dung of an impala. And that's some impala droppings right there. The tracks of an impala in this particular substrate don't look like much. I can potentially try and show you this one here. This is a track of an impala right here. This is the back of the track, there and there. And this is the front of the track, and there's the ridge going through between the toes. Very, very difficult to show you, Carl. Nevertheless, that is the track of impala. And Brent's got a hyena that he wants to show you. Before that runs away, I think you need to go there.
So we really seem to be struggling to get going this morning. As we drove around the corner on our way to Arethusa, it was a hyena. He just swallowed, or she just swallowed, a large bone. And on the ground next to it was a hooded vulture who's flown up into the tree. But now the hyena's off, finished with whatever morsel it had. I really wish I knew where it came from. Is it the kudu that was stolen? Oh, so many unanswered questions that the bush leaves us. There goes the hyena. Just double checking that there's nothing else around. And then what we saw before we saw the hyena, VM spotted that hooded vulture that was sitting on the ground next to the hyena. There we go. Now you can see the smallest of the vulture species and that very, very distinct face. Now, if you've ever watched any sort of old British medieval comedy, particularly the Blackadder, the hooded vulture always reminds me of sort of the gallows keeper. They wear that weird leather hood. But they've got very, very fine little bills, so they're unable to sort of open carcasses, so they specialize in picking up little scraps. I think we're going to move on and let that vulture come see if it can find any scraps that the hyena left. And hopefully, we're going to keep moving through and trying to get an update on the Tsalalas. So hopefully I'll have some good news for you shortly. I also heard more elephants around the corner. So, as I said, baboons are, being a primate, are actually quite smart, and they do figure out that there's food in the camps, and Jen's wondering, will they start raiding camps for food? Fortunately, we've got a very good system, so all the rubbish and that goes into a cage, and that's to stop baboons and hyenas in particular starting to associate the camps with food. So if they're unable to get that food, they generally don't become a problem. So that's why all rubbish, all food is always in a very secure area. It's so monkeys and baboons and hyenas don't start associating the camps with food. I have a look at the tracks around here. I really wonder what that hyena was eating. We're seeing if it any leopard tracks. Could it have stolen from a leopard? Oh, let's jump across to Jamie quickly, who's got baboons shouting.
I've stopped here on Bufflesford Cutline, and I'm just going to be really quiet for a moment because we've got a sound we don't often hear. A male baboon barking out in alarm and probably anger. There they are, racing across Biffle's Hook cut line. It's wonderful that we're seeing more and more baboons, but the reason they are so upset today is that, of course, an Nkuhuma lioness has caught one of them. Relatively unusual, not unheard of, obviously, but relatively unusual for a lion to be quick enough to catch a baboon whilst it's on the ground. But that is what's happened, and that's why this baboon troop is so upset and why that male is constantly bow, bow, calling across the... And it's echoing perfectly across this ridge. Let's get a little bit closer, because there's a chance that there's still a lion there that's upsetting them.
Monzie into Torchwood.
Isn't it amazing just how many more baboon sightings we've had in the last... few weeks, far more than we've had in the last year combined since I've been here. And I think that that's going to continue. I think they're going to start pushing further in to Juma. Our baboons' distribution is very much, in most cases, dictated by the habitat that it's in. Now they need nice, safe sleeping spots, which means very tall trees or cliff faces, where they feel secure enough to settle down for the evening, out of reach of things like lions and hyena, but also from leopard. And that's one of the reasons why we haven't seen that many in this area, since we don't have a big river system with some of the old, old large trees. We've got a couple around the Mulwati drainage line, but not all that many. There he is, sitting looking like, he's running. What a pity. No, you got him. Here he goes. Well done, Jandre. Here's the troop. This group not quite as comfortable as the Sydney's Dan Sandy Patch group. They're still very, very nervous. Oh, rolling backwards. Now, Kathy in Tennessee, you're wondering about whether or not baboons or vervet monkeys get along, or if they are natural enemies. Oh, there we go, climbing up onto the top of a termite mound. The Kathy, oh, no, Wendy, you've got to stay in gear. I'm in gear. You've got to stay there. That's not Jean-André's camera work, by the way. That's Wendy rolling backwards gently down the hill. Shame. They're very upset. Kathy, baboons and monkeys, not natural enemies at all, and very often seen associating in the same groups. In feeding groups when there's lots of fruit, for example, anywhere in those sorts of areas. The baboons, naturally, just being far larger than a vervet monkey, will take a more dominant status, since they're just as fast and they're quite good at climbing, almost as good as a vervet monkey at climbing trees. The monkeys make sure that they don't antagonize the baboons in any way. I think that's pretty much going to be the best view that we've had of them, and of course you had them with Brent earlier. Now let's carry on, but let's continue. You got one. Oh. Is there a baboon there?
Mm. Behind the dead stick.
Yes, I see the movement. Well done, Jean-André. Oh, it's got such a tiny baby on the back. Really, really small. Now, initially, when a female baboon has her baby, when she first gives birth, and the records show that they tend to give birth at night in the tree itself, which is quite a feat, considering. But what they'll do initially, because the babies aren't well developed enough to actually climb with them, or climb... No, this is... Wendy does not... Wendy wants to send us careering back into the ditch. I don't think we need to. I don't think we're going to get a better view, so I'm not going to sit here much longer. I have a vague feeling that we're going to disappear. So initially the poor mother has to have her baby and then keep up with the rest of the troop, but she can't, the baby can't sit on her back in its first few days of life, so she's actually got to carry it with one hand and then run with just one front foot. And you've seen the way that baboons run, they can stand up on their hind legs, but they do walk, their natural running position, or their natural moving is on all fours. And she will do that, but she's very fortunate in that she's got an exceptionally protective troop around her. Margaret, there's a really interesting, you were wondering about, we're on the subject of the families, is a baboon troop matriarchal? And the answer is no. It's actually technically classified as something called an oligarchy. An oligarchy meaning that there are several unrelated but nevertheless fully grown dominant males within the group. And there's a fascinating structure to a baboon troop. You've got several different females, and there is a hierarchy within a female baboon troop. And what that means is that it's kind of similar to a hyena clan, in that you've got one mother with her sisters and her older daughters, and they will inherit her status, but with her youngest baby being the most dominant of that group. And then there'll be another family with a separate mother line, matrilineal line, that will be a part of the same troop but not related. And there is a hierarchy within those female genetic lines. And that status, as I said, is inherited from the female baboon. But from there on, it becomes really interesting, because the baboon troops are dominated by those big males. And you'll find that within baboon troops, certain males have certain preferences for females, that they spend a great deal of time grooming or being groomed, mostly, by the females that they prefer. And then the other males will have their females that they prefer. And so there's very little competition, and generally just an acceptance amongst the dominant males when one of them gets to mate with a female. But what's even more incredible about that is these godfathers, they're known as the godfathers, of a baboon troop. These godfathers, if a female dies and her infant is too young to survive on its own, the male that shows a preference for her will actually adopt her baby, even if it's not his, even if he's a newcomer and the baby clearly can't be his, he will still adopt that baby and attempt to look after it. And there's a lot of theories as to why that is. They are, of course, very close to humans in terms of, or at least closer than, say, a lion or a leopard. Now, there is a very strong emotional development within baboons, but not just that. There's also the chance that he will curry favor with her daughters and with that particular family line, that particular female line of baboons. So it might be to his advantage as well. But in that sense, they truly are an interesting group to study. Now, James, you were wondering about the size difference between a male and a female baboon track. Now, in body size, a male baboon is twice the weight of a female. They're much, much bigger. There's a huge sexual dimorphism there because of the competition to enter into different troops and to have mating opportunities, but also because the males act as defenders of the troop. So, in essence, a male's track will be close to double the size of a female's. Finally, there you are. Where have you been hiding? Found a young bull, and he is on the move. He isn't really going to stop, I don't think. Let's just give him a chance to decide where he wants to go. Because we're behind him, I don't want to pressurize him. Now, before we start chatting about the Ellie and while he's hidden away, just to finish off with James Richards' question and to broaden it ever so slightly, the track's being about double the size. But then also there's a slight difference in the swagger, the way in which they walk. The males often swing their back legs right out to the outside of their front legs. And then in a more broad term, just to finish off talking about the size difference, a male has a canine of about 2.5 inches long. Incredibly long teeth, as long as a leopard or a lion, if not longer. Females do not have that in any way. But there's very, very large sexual dimorphism. Just sit for 1 second. Three blind mice. It's a chin spot battus. Right, well, I'm going to see if I can find us a nice position and a nice view of this elephant while I do that. And having talked about baboons, Steph would like to show you a baboon's tail.
So from baboon tracks and baboons to a baboon's tail. Now, this isn't a baboon's tail that we've planted in here. This is actually a plant called a baboon's tail. And there you can have a look at it, all dry and doesn't have its beautiful purple flowers that it gets on. But it does have a very interesting traditional use. And the use that this is used for in a traditional sense is these plants are quite often planted in the yards or in the gardens of sangomas or local medicine men, shamans for lack of a better word. And this plant is used in a shaman's garden to ward off lightning. So the baboon's tail plant, planted in a shaman's garden out here, is used to ward off lightning and quite often is one of the telltale signs that a shaman or a shaman in training out here, we call them sangomas. A sangoma here, or the link between the people and their ancestors in the afterlife, is a shaman, or the sangoma. They use these plants to ward off lightning. Isn't that amazing? Now, we've reached the crest of where we are, and I must say it's probably about as dry for animals as what the valley was, as what the drainage line was. The only thing that we're hearing constantly is we're being pushed further south by a herd of elephant that is busy coming up behind us. Now, generally speaking, I would say let's wait and see what we can with these herd of elephant. But as you can see where we are now, the bush is absolutely not the best place at the moment for an approaching elephant herd. We've only got roughly 20 yards or 30 yards of visible bush open to us, and with the screams and the trumpets and the rumbles and the grumbles that are coming from this particular elephant herd, we're just slowly making our way away from them rather than making our way to them. Nevertheless, let's carry on going and see what we can find. The day is starting to heat up quite nicely. I don't know if you notice, I haven't quite got a sheen of sweat on my forehead just yet, but you'll see the reflections of the bush surrounding me starting to increase as the day goes on. It's probably going to be one of those typical autumn days where it started off nice and crisp in the morning and it ends off as a baking hot day around about 25 to 30 degrees centigrade. Coming back. And Jim has just asked me a question. Excuse me for going quiet there. I'm just busy looking at this stone locust here, which I'll try and see if I can show you. But I'm going to get back to Jim's question. Jim wanted to know if that mucus, that nasal bone structure we find in the mucous membrane or in the nasal mucosa of that impala had anything to do with cooling. That is a good question there. I think absolutely it could have. It's very feasible. So basically what Jim's doing is he's saying that the airflow across the bone is going to cool the bone, that then will move into the horn structure, or vice versa. Heat from the nose will move into the horn structure to be shed out of the horn structure. Equally, temperature from the horn structure will move into the nasal membrane, cooling or heating airflow that goes into the lungs. That's a very, very feasible thing there, Jim. That's good. Good answer. I like feedback like that. And you obviously welcome, any of you are welcome to share any theories or any thoughts that you have. We obviously enjoy them, and I'll try and address as many as we can. You can send them through, if you don't know already, to questions@wildearth.tv or use the Twitter handle, the hashtag SafariLIVE. Now, back to this locust that I was trying to see as we came in here. Now, generally, these type of stone locusts, I'm noticing, stay hidden right up until the last moment. And they are so super camouflaged. Myself and Viam saw one last week that literally had fuzzy eyeballs. There we go. He jumped. Okay. So, right next to my shoe here, Dave. There we go. Okay, he's gone into the open. I'm going to show... Okay, well, he's busy jumping away. He's gone. I'm going to have to find you another one. Right, they're actually quite common things, to be quite honest with you. They sort of triggered jumping by moving your feet through the grass. You see, here's another one here. At the tip of this grass, Dave, is a grasshopper. Can you see it? I think you're keying your mark. Just the tip there. I think you're keying your mark. All right. Sorry, we're just in a very awkward position over here. Dave's got this big backpack on his back. He's also got the camera that he's trying to get into an angle for to show you a microscopic grasshopper, which is exactly the opposite of...
Guys, we've unfortunately not found Tsalalas, but we've got the Tsalala bride here. And it looks like they've spotted something in the little river system up ahead, and they've gone into stalk mode. So we can only see four. I can see four lines at the moment. You can see the tailless lioness there. So I'm just speaking very quietly, trying to figure out what they might have spotted. So there's
evil river system up ahead of them. And I'm quite excited to catch up with the Tsalala pride. I haven't seen them in quite a while. Maybe they've heard something, maybe not seen something. I'm just going to move forward slightly. There we go, the tallest lioness. The grand dam of the Tsalala pride. So, looks like they might lie down and they're listening. So we've got the young male at the back. You can see the other female just ahead, and the tailless females laying down behind a bush. There are some impala rutting that I can hear not too far away. That could be possibly what they're interested in.
Brent's on Arethusa with the Tsalalas. Yeah. Oh dear. And it seems as though I'm going to have to redirect the camera there so that we can finish off with the test. Brent disappeared off your screen. And we were just busy testing things with the radio and sorting cables out. So Jean-André wasn't even on the vehicle then at that point. He was trying to fix stuff at the back. We do apologize for that. I'm glad to see that Brent has found the Tsalala pride. We can. Are you ready, Jean-André, now?
Sort of, kind of.
We tack up the gremlins this morning. Okay, Jean-André is on board now, vaguely looking a little bit flustered. I'm going to send you back over to Brent and his lions, and he can tell you the story of that injury that Tristan showed us the pictures of on the young Tsalala male many months ago.
So, apparently there's some giraffe as well on the other side of the crest. Sorry about that, we just needed to change camera batteries. It is getting a bit warm, so they might lie up here for the day. There's one of the young males. So I just spoke to the other guides when we disappeared there. It seems like it's not the full pride, just these three that are here. He's going to be a big boy. Here we go, you can see the other lioness. I'm going to move. Oh, no. She's on the move. Just going to. There we go, look at that. She's definitely focusing in on something. I'm still looking. So I heard there are some giraffe over there, and there are impala. And being around a little river system, there might be a nyala. But in this area, it literally could be anything. She should pop out in front of that copse bush willow shortly. There she is. We should be. So she does look a little hungry. Not starving. Look at those muscles. Isn't this just spectacular? What has she seen? The other lions aren't reacting. Watch how carefully she places her foot when she's stalking to try and minimize any sound. We have a look just there. There's a little river system. You can see the Timbuerti trees around there. So there could be something in those thickets.
You have a beagle on the bobcat.
Do I have?
Beagle on the bobcat.
Yes. Oh, the young male.
No, the stumpy tail.
Oh, the stumpy tail. Oh, Vim's now nicknamed the tailless lioness, the bobcat. She's lying down. There she is. Well, we don't want to move at the moment. Now, we did hear some impala rutting. Oh, tailless lioness looks like. No, she's just listening. She might get moving shortly. I'm just going to take my jacket off. It's getting quite warm. There, the other lioness is going towards that little river system. See how she's dropping her head? I think there might be something closer that we're just not seeing. Isn't that just the most incredible thing? You can see those muscles, that sort of latent energy. Now the lioness hasn't stood up yet. Now, for me, it's quite incredible that I used to watch this pride back in the mid-2000s in the center of the Savi Sands. And the mother of the tailless lioness we see now was also tailless. It's just incredible. I mean, the odds are so small. Still no movement from the others. They're just watching her intently. Oh, here comes the tailors. And VM is nicknamed the bobcat.
Well, like a saber too.
VM, we mentioned she's a very big lioness. So VM's changed his mind. She's not a bobcat, she's a saber-toothed cat. very interested in something on the other side. So even though they might be stalking now, they've stopped there and listening intently, watching, I'm still trying to figure out what's on the other side of this little river system that they're showing so much interest in. Don't really want to move the car too much now. We don't want to affect what's happening. But it looks like they've gone flat, so we will move in a little bit. I just want to wait a few more minutes. VM, let's try see what they've spotted. So VM's now just having a look on the southern side of that little river system. We're trying to see if we can see any animals there that their acute senses have picked up, and of course us being human beings and a bit slow, we haven't spotted yet. Now it might look like a bit of a heat haze in the camera. But it's not because it's hot, it's because the engine is hot and Vim is just zooming in directly across the engine. So there we go, there's the lioness. Just see that ear flicking? We're going to stay here and see what happens. If there's any action, we'll be right back. But Steph's got something small and interesting to show you.
And from one ambush specialist to another, and I've been looking for this particular spider for weeks now, and we managed to find you one. This is a flower-like crab spider, and you can see she's in her absolute glory there. And I'm so happy we found it. She's busy sitting on that leaf, looking like a camouflage flower, and she's hoping to pick off flies and bees is what she preys on. And what's extra special about this particular spider at the moment is she's got a male that's busy mating with her. He's almost 100 times smaller than what she is. Now, very difficult to see him because he's actually lying underneath her at the moment. But if you look very carefully at the end of her abdomen in that shot that you can see, you might see two of his orange legs busy poking out on the sides, holding her abdomen. Where the abdomen joins the cephalothorax, her head, that is where you'll see his 2 feet. And he's busy mating with her at the moment. She's sitting dead still on that flower. You can see those two horns where her eyes are. She uses those as camouflage, but she also uses them to judge distance. This particular spider has binocular vision, which means that she can judge depth, which means that she can snag a bee or a fly out of flight as it comes within range of her long front legs. Another interesting thing about this particular spider is that her venom is keyed to bees and to flies, and it is almost instant paralysis for a flying insect. Can you imagine for something like a bee that's equipped with, in spider terms at least anyway, a harpoon in their abdomen? She needs to be able to incapacitate her prey as quickly as possible, and for that she has evolved a venom that is so virulent to bees it almost instantaneously incapacitates or paralyzes them. And I'm so happy that we found it. To be honest, it's one of my best sightings of one. I'm so glad we got to show you that. But this is obviously not as exciting as Brent's lions for a lot of you, and we need to go and see what they're up to at the moment.
So the young male walked up to the lionesses and sort of broke their concentration a bit. But I think whatever they were stalking is a bit further away. But they're still definitely interested in something up ahead. The general direction is south, and we're not too far away from the boundary. So hopefully, whatever they're interested in is this side. And they are heading this way. Doug drove around. He says there's some giraffe up there, there's some zebra, there's some impala. There's quite a lot of animals up ahead. But they're not in stalk mode properly anymore. Well, we try to get into a better position with these cats. Jamie's got some elephants to show you.
While Brent gets into a slightly better position, I found some trees for you. Chardo's having a good chuckle. There's an absolutely enormous elephant behind those trees. Beautiful big bull. And I mean, he's really one of the biggest we've seen. But he, unfortunately, is feeling somewhat camera shy. Let's try and see. Oh, no. I don't think that there is any possibility of finding him once again for you. Here's a view of his bottom through a leaf. The reason I'm pushing forward, the reason I'm pushing to show you, and it's impossible for you to get a sense of scale. Yes, there's a tail swishing. I just would like to have been able to show you just how large he really is. I mean, he must be a good 5 meter, 15 feet at the shoulder, easily. The kind of big bull that would absolutely dwarf you in comparison to his massive bulk. I was hoping he was going to come and say hello, because a lot of the time these big elephant bulls are so comfortable and secure in their own skin and feel so unthreatened by pretty much everyone, for good reason. I mean, you don't really want to pick a fight with a 6-ton elephant. What that means is that they sometimes come and glance down at you sort of benignly before wandering off. But he, as a Kruger elephant, who's come in most likely from the east, I don't think he's feeling terribly like being on camera. He's a little bit shy. He's also found himself a really nice shade patch in there. And it's starting to heat up after our chilly, nippy morning. I'm definitely feeling much warmer than I was. So far, so good. It seems as though Wendy's demons have been excised, and we are back on the road, and Wendy seems to be functioning just fine. While we carry on to test that theory, let's back across to Brent and his lines.
So, the lines are just off to the right of us. I'm trying to put us in the best position where we can see what's going on from a bit of a distance. So I'm just going to go up into this open section here. The lioness should be there, but there's giraffe and baby giraffe just off to our left. So there's the giraffe. There's the lion. She's gone flat now. But apparently there's some baby giraffe with this group, and lions love baby giraffe. So I can't see the second lioness or the young male. That's the tailless female we can see there. Well, the giraffe hasn't spotted them yet. Or it might have now. It's looking intently. So many of you are wondering how this beautiful big lioness became a tailless lioness. As far as I know, it happened in a fight with the hyenas, which is the exact way her mother lost her tail as well. So, the name Tsalala comes from a tree and a pan down in the central Sabi Sands called Tsalala Pan. And at the edge of Tsalala Pan, and the reason it's got that name, is a large low-fold gardenia. So that's the Shangan name for a low-fold gardenia. So this is the second pride of lions that I know of in the Sabi Sands that's named after a tree. Now, the temperature has warmed up considerably. Now, this is where the patience game plays an important part. So, separating the giraffe and the lions is about 100 meters. I don't see any baby giraffe. I think they might be further back behind the others. So there we go. The giraffe are just over here. The lions are 100 meters or so there. I think the giraffe have spotted the lions because they wouldn't be looking at us like that. You can see them staring intently. Well, there's two that have come down here and are staring intently towards the lions. I think they're still coming a bit closer to the giraffe, trying to get a better view. So when a cat goes still, it makes it harder to see. So quite often, giraffes use their height to spot them. And if the cat's not moving, the giraffe will often walk closer to try make sure that it's a potential threat, and that's exactly what these giraffes are doing at the moment. So she's definitely watching them. So, giraffes are one of the bigger and harder prey species for a lion to go after. And Ellen's wondering, would the mother giraffe defend her baby against the lions? She most certainly would try, but there would be a point where she would just abandon it. Look at this giraffe there. It's coming closer and closer. There she is. She's definitely staring there, so she's not 100% sure that there's a predator there yet. That's why she keeps coming closer and closer to look. Now, small pride, she might be a bit big for, but a young giraffe wouldn't. But you never know. Stranger things have happened with lions and giraffes, and it's not impossible that three lions might be able to take down an adult female giraffe. So she's probably now at about 80 meters from the lions. Well, from the lion we can see, at least. There are two others we can't. She looks like she's looking back for the other lioness. Now, there's been a lot of stuff done on how lions hunt and cooperative hunting strategies in social predators. And I truly believe a lot of the cues that lions work off while hunting are visual. So they actually need to see each other to to make certain decisions while in the hunt. Justin's wondering, how long will a lion stalk its prey before it will give up? Now, Justin, it completely depends on each individual scenario, but they can sometimes stalk and attempt to chase specifically big animals for an extended period of time. Other times, if it's something small, they give up quite easily once they're spotted. With giraffe, again, it very much varies. Keeps looking back, so I'm presuming the other lioness is in that direction. And the young male probably be lounging somewhere at the back. You see, there comes another lioness for you. I think they've given up. I think they realize they've been spotted by the giraffe. Oh. Oh, look how muscular she is. She is a massive lioness. And she does look quite funny without that tail. She's walking directly towards us, but I think she's going to stop in that patch of shade. Boom, and she's definitely been spotted by the giraffe now, both of them have. So hunt over, snooze time is now. Now, there we go, the giraffe are still keeping a very close eye on the lions, and that's not unusual behavior at all. But that was quite exciting watching her creep, but definitely being spotted. And I know two of our viewers' favorite animals in one sighting. Isn't that wonderful? There actually are quite a few giraffe beyond. I can just see heads sticking out, but there you go, look at her, she's going closer again, saying, I see you lions, I got you in my eyesight. That's the end of the lion action. They're now going to go back to doing what lions do best, which is sleep. They do sleep on average for about 20 hours a day. And even their activity is in short bouts. So when I first heard about the lions, they were sleeping and they moved for 20 minutes, half an hour, and they've gone back to sleep. Giraffe has now decided, okay, I know they're lions, I know they're here, I'm out of here. So, let's go see if we can get a slightly closer look at those girls. Try to get on the right side of the light. So Justin's wondering. Sorry, I'm just going to listen because everyone else is leaving, so we're the only ones here, just in case someone else has is trying to come here. But Justin's wondering, would female lions be more aggressive in defending of their territory than a coalition of males? I'd probably say it's the same. They both are very aggressive in defending their territory. Males probably a little bit more so. There you go. That's the younger of the two lionesses. And a very pretty girl. So they've got a young male. He's still quite young. I guess he's around two, maybe even a little bit below two. And Jen's wondering if they caught something small like a duiker. Would the female eat it herself or would the male steal it? He's not big enough and strong enough. There would be a fight between all three of them over it. But normally the biggest, strongest lion wins, and that's the one in shot at the moment. The bobcat slash saber-toothed tailless lioness of the Tsalalas. She's still watching the giraffe, even though she knows she's been spotted. Incredibly muscular lioness. And the temperature is warming up rapidly at the moment. Oh, and there the head's getting heavy. That one's already fallen to ground. Young male's probably sleeping in the shade behind somewhere. They do look so comfortable when they decide to conk out. So Dory in South Carolina is wondering whether these lions have any cubs. Dory, to be completely honest, I don't know. We don't see them enough. I don't see any signs of pregnancy. They are in a bit of turmoil at the moment. Normally they would fall under the Majinga lions, but the Matimbas have been spending a lot of time in their traditional territory. That's why we've been seeing them up north a bit more often. And in areas they're not used to being seen in, like Sydney's Dam. But it's possible that one of them might be pregnant, but I think it's highly unlikely with the lion dynamics that are happening in their normal territory at the moment. Well, we all know the saying about letting sleeping dogs lie. We're going to let sleeping lions lie and see what else we can find. But before we leave these lions, just a quick update. We were heading across here to look for Salaheshe, and she was on a kill on Saffron Road. She finished that with the help of the Anderson male, and both of them are now, unfortunately, to the south of our traverse area. So fingers crossed they might come back soon. But one last look at some lazy Tsalala lions sleeping in the shade. They should be around here come sunset safari, so definitely might be worth following up. Probably not the longest sighting, as we are very close to the southern boundary. Toodles, Tsalala girls, and Tsalala boy lying back there somewhere. So while we maneuver out of this block, let's go across to Steph on foot.
So where you were looking at the predator, all of a sudden we've become the prey. And what you can see over there is you can see a buffalo bull that's busy staring benevolently, or malevolently, I should actually say, sorry, malevolently in our direction. I have a belief that buffalo were born angry, and the expression on this particular bull's face and his friend's face confirms that fact for me. So buffalo on foot are something that we really need to take care of. They're used to being hunted from a very, very young age, from calves. They're used to being hunted, and they build up this resilience to predators and an intolerance for predators. And we are obviously the Earth's greatest predator, and buffalo see us as that. We've been hunting them for centuries, and they don't take kindly to being disturbed. Now, we didn't disturb these buffalo, and the good thing is that we've got the wind blowing from them to us. They haven't done any threatening moves for us at the moment. Basically, they just let us know they're there. They made a bit of a snort. They stood up, and we can see them. They haven't run over in our direction, but it is something that we take great care of to try and avoid upsetting. Now, generally, when you've got buffalo this close and on foot, it engages a reaction, needs to engage a reaction from us. And what we'll do is we tighten up the group, and generally we try and move to elevated position with the wind in our face, creating distance. What these buffalo want is they want us to create distance. At the moment, we're in what's called their alert zone. They know we're here, we know they're there, but we at the moment don't represent a threat to one another. And what we're going to try and do is move out of their alert zone. Obviously, as we spend more time here, pressure increases, and that alert zone can actually extend past us to what's called their warning zone, where they will try and chase us away if they can. What we're going to try and do is move away from the buffalo, and keeping them in view. You don't want them to see you hiding. They don't want you to, or you, I don't want them to think we're hunting them by hiding. And so what we're going to try and do is move away from them, keeping them in view. They can hear me quite clearly. This is one of those things that we do, is I like to talk to the animals. They hear from my tone of voice that I'm not being threatening. And now I'm a good couple of meters away. He can still hear me, but now we're going to put some bushes between us and him, and we're going to walk into the wind. And let's carry on going. We'll probably be able to see these buffalo as we keep on going. Now, buffalo being gregarious, quite often there's more than one buffalo. Now, I could see two buffalo there, but you might find that there's some other buffalo here as well. And what we want to try and do is make a circuitous route around these buffalo and any that might be in the particular area that we're in at the moment. Now, it does look like I'm on a bit of high alert over here, and it may be contradictory to how you actually see me walking through the bush most of the time. I can be quite blasé about where we are. It's just one of these things, every now and again, just jolts you, boom, that you are sharing this place with animals that have a reputation for doing harm to people. That said, is that we're all full of respect, and I'm a firm believer that the more we respect these animals, the more that they'll respect us. In particular, as our conservation areas are getting smaller and smaller, and these animals are forced to defend their last refuges, I think that being as respectful to them as possible is the only way forward, and to live in harmony. We're not here to hurt them, they're not here to hurt us. Alright, so we've still got the wind in our faces, which is good. Astrid wanted to know if ostriches would react the same as those buffalo do on foot. Would they stand and stare at us? Oh, sorry, Joey, excuse me, Joey. Joey wanted to know if ostriches would run away, or if they'd stare malevolently at us like those buffalo did. It also depends on their zone. If you're in the alert zone of an ostrich, he won't run away from you. They're going to carry on doing exactly what they wanted to do. Stand there, carry on eating, watching you though. If you were in their warning zone, they absolutely would run away. Now, Animal zones, these zones of comfort, warning, fight or flight, they move constantly. Wind direction can change it. The condition of that animal can change it. The time of year, the time of day, your actions can change it as well. So it all depends on that animal at the time, at this time of day, at this exact moment. That'll determine what they do. So I would say that to answer your question, Zoe, they're going to probably exhibit exactly the same behavior as what we saw from those buffalo. And it wouldn't be any different. All right. We're threading our way through some thick bush over here. Dave, that'll hook you, and so will this. You can see some of the thorns here that we're talking about. Have a look at those thorns. That particular one doesn't have too many, but you can see, let me open it up for you, hidden behind these rather bland looking leaves. I hear some that are uncovered. Are these viciously hooked thorns? And I think that this is a very good place before we go down into this thick bush where there might be some more buffalo hiding for us to say goodbye. Now, what I want to say really is thank you very much for joining us on the bushwalk this morning. The highlight for me was that crab spider. And if any of you got some screen grabs, please feel free to send it through to us. I'd love to see if we've got that male clasping on it. But from myself and Dave, we just want to say thank you very much for all your questions and your input. And we'll see you tomorrow morning again for another bushwalk.
We come to the end of what was, for Jandre and myself, a relatively unsuccessful sunrise safari. Now here you've all been hiding, Zebra. Oh yes, attack of the gremlins this morning. It happens every now and again. But we should be back up and running by the sunset safari this afternoon. And you get to see more views of animals such as these lovely zebra. We've got zebra of all ages, the sub-adult at the back there. And as they walk in the sunlight and as they walk past each other, you do get a chance to kind of see just how well those stripes can work, at least for the human eye, in terms of obscuring one individual animal's shape from the other. Oh. A little bit of aggression. Zebra are very aggressive animals, particularly the females. They spend a lot of time kicking and putting little foals in their place, and oh, there's a very tiny baby at the back there. Young and very wobbly. It's definitely one of the youngest zebra I've seen in a while. Only a couple of weeks old. Wonderful to see the zebra back once again. We go through patches of zebra droughts, in a way, where we hardly ever see them, and then all of a sudden the place just seems to be teeming with black and white stripy bodies. Getting smacked in the face there by Mom's tail as she swishes the flies away. Sure, it's a very big herd. It's a very, very big herd. This is probably actually a combination of two herds together with a stallion. As you know, a typical zebra herd combination would be a stallion with his collection of mares and youngsters. But in this case, this is a... Oh, there's that aggressive female again. She's quite moody this morning. This number of females would have to be a very, very impressive stallion. All right, well, we come to the end of our sunrise safari. Thank you, as always, to Jandre and to the lovely ladies in final control and to all of you, the viewers. I'm going to send you back across to Brent for the last few moments of the sunrise safari. Cheers.
So it has been an ecstatic... Oh, ecstatic. I'm ecstatic after the safari. Really great to catch up with the Salada girls. And what a beautiful morning. The light, the colors, a big tusker elephant, a hyena, lots of little critters with Steph on bushwalk. But alas, the leopard luck still runs dry. But the lion luck seems to be in full fettle. That's 4 days in a row with lions and 2 different prides.
and the Inkahumas and a Birmingham and now the Tsalalas. And fantastic news is, I know, I'm sure it's been spread far and wide, but the Inkahumas, or one of the Inkahuma ladies, has given birth to two cubs. She's keeping them in a den in a rocky area of Torchwood. Very exciting stuff. So hopefully in about 3 weeks she might be moving them around and we might get lucky enough to see them. But it is only a few short hours before the sun sets, Safari, so don't forget to join us for all sorts of fantastic things. I think we're going to definitely have some really great elephant viewing, but hopefully the cats are back. So from all of us here at Safari Live, have a wonderful day and see you just now.